Jigs and Bigs is proud to announce we're being supported by Old Glory Outdoors. They're a veteran-owned company that carries fishing and hunting gear. Plus, they're highly active in supporting veteran organizations and charities. Old Glory is an authorized dealer of Favorite Rods, FX Rods, Guggen Baits, X-Zone Lures, Sixth Sense, and many more. There's a brick-and-mortar store located in East Brookfield, Massachusetts, but you can also order online at oldgloryoutdoors.com. They ship anywhere in the lower 48 states or order online and pick up at the store. When you order, use the promo code JIGSANDBIGS and you'll save 10% off your complete order. Plus, you'll help support the show. Make sure to check out the apparel line called OGO Gear while you're there. Old Glory Outdoors believes in the slogan "Start 'em Young" to keep kids away from screens and enjoying nature. They've got a full array of live bait too. Check out oldgloryoutdoors.com and use the promo code JIGSANDBIGS. Save some money and gear up now. What's up, guys? Bobby Roastbeef here for Jigs and Bigs. It is another... What a weekend, I got to tell you. It's another episode of the show, and we got a doozy for it. I got Sean the Fisherman with me. Sean, how are you this morning, bud?
I'm good, but the big question is how are you? You guys had a rough weekend.
Yeah, we did have a rough weekend. And it's turning into a rough Monday, too, because this in my cup right here is not my regular Monsoon coffee from Monsoon Coffee Roasters. This is, it's actually grocery store-bought Starbucks, and I've been spoiled. I miss my Monsoon. I think that started my day on a bad note. And it's just
for the listeners who cannot see what you're holding up. It appears to be a 2.5 gallon bucket filled with coffee.
Yeah, it's I have painted one of the Homer buckets from Home Depot. And, you know, that's just how I roll. Yeah, it was a rough weekend. Definitely. I mean, you had an exciting weekend. You had some bragworthy fish, some decent fish on there.
Yeah, a lot of housework and one really good fish. I don't want to spoil anything, but I'm gonna throw a lot of that in the fishery report. But what do you want to know that I can tell you?
I think that's just to glaze over your weekend. It's pretty good. You got a lot accomplished. You got a nice bragworthy fish. I went out with four other skilled gentlemen on the water, and every single one of them outfished me. But nothing that we caught was really of any kind of significance or quality necessarily. So it was interesting. And then we shared an experience. We had a shared experience afterwards. And we'll get into that in just a moment. It didn't include banjos or anything like that. Calm down.
That would have been easier on you guys.
I think, yes. Oh, my God. Well, there's more you didn't even know about. Like, there's more. So last night, all right, let's go ahead. We'll just dive right into it. So this weekend was like my birthday weekend. I turned 28. No, I turned 43. And this weekend, it was the first year in a while that my birthday fell on a Saturday. So I had, a bunch of stuff to do. You know, I had a really good, my last night of work was Friday night of the week and had a great time over there. Interesting twist at the end of that night, too. And then Saturday was spent kind of gearing up and getting ready for what happened on Sunday. What went down on Sunday was something that Wild Bill from Hookset Hoodlums and I had talked about a little bit, was the idea of getting together and doing a challenge. We're always trying to figure out ways to collaborate. Hookset Hoodlums is a company that makes apparel. They're getting into bait making, and they also have a big social footprint right now. They do a lot with Instagram, which they're killing it on, and they have a growing YouTube channel as well. So I came up with this idea that we would just do a little get together, and Sean and I have both shared that we love fishing with listeners, guests, you name it, people that are involved with the show, like I think sometimes getting to meet folks over at the water and just spending a day, like, you know, just kind of BSing and catching fish and doing what we love is really kind of the best sort of perk that comes with what we do with this show and this podcast. So we had decided the way we would do is organize a group of people collectively. And this is a number of weeks back. And we would meet up at some water and then divide up into teams in sort of a random style. So we used an app that has a wheel where we put all the names on there. And that's how we figured out the teams. And then what we would do is we'd hit the water for a pre-measured amount of time, go out, then come back. And we would just do a numbers game and set up a little bit of a challenge. And what that challenge was, and I had alluded to it on Instagram, was I had brought with me a bottle of hot sauce that is infamous from the show Hot Ones on YouTube. And now I guess there's a Hot Ones game show, like an actual game show now on TV, which is kind of interesting, and a board game that you can play at home. But the sauce that I picked wasn't the sauce that's usually at the end that everybody thinks will be the hottest one. This is the one that I feel consecutively brings people back to reality of like, oh, this is not going to be pleasant. Every time. It's the one that Shaq kind of got famous with on that show. He was talking smack about Kansas City and got humbled real quick. This is Da Bomb, Beyond Insanity. And Da Bomb comes from a line of five different hot sauces. And this is from 1 to 5, 1 being the least spicy. This is number 2. And when you see this video, it will blow your mind. We left the GoPro recording accidentally while we were all reacting to this. And the idea was that the losing team was supposed to eat the hot sauce. That was the idea. And no, we didn't have wings because I don't want to leave wings out at the boat launch. Just chilling in a cooler, just have them gross. So instead, we used tortilla chips. And I'm glad I bought such a big bag because we needed them. What we did was this. I, like I said, everybody outfished me, but I was on the winning team. So there was myself. We had Wild Bill. We had Andrew, also from Hookshead Hoodlums. We also had Delirious Angler that joined us. And we had, Joel, Brutus17 on Instagram. He's one of the pro staffers for Hookshead Hoodlums. Great to meet Joel. We had an awesome, awesome time. We also realized that our emoticons on iPhone are pretty much the same. My beard is just slightly grayer than his. We're like twins. Weird. Anyway, we went out and had a great time, and my team was the victorious one. We won, I think, 6-4, but that's only because when it came to bass, fish that we were counting, Andrew and Joel each got 3 apiece, and I caught nothing but the wrong species all day long. So it was no good. This would have been great in the chronic trips. If we were doing that, I think I probably would have done – it would have helped me a lot. I would have got some points. But – nothing. Yeah, it was just, oh, God, talk about humbling. So when we got back to the launch and we measured everybody's catches for the day, and what we did was this was on Instagram. So if you were following our stories, you saw each of us posting on our story catches that were coming in with our accounts all tagged in there. So our pictures were all over the place. It was kind of crazy. Well, I say our pictures, their pictures. I didn't catch shit. So I had nothing to photograph. So I'm like, okay, great. We get back to the launch and we you know, pack up all the yaks and get everything all taken care of. Now it's challenge time. So I've got Wild Bill and I've got Delirious, and they each have to eat this hot sauce. And I felt like, because I wasn't even on the board, I kind of had to jump in it with them. I kind of, as a note to, I guess, just being there for them, I suppose, and being involved with part of their pain. Plus, I've been there before. I've eaten this hot sauce too many times. I've never had it hit me the way this did. So this hot sauce had never been opened before, and it was in the truck. So it was very runny. It didn't need to be shaken out of the bottle at all. We each took a chip and put put a liberal amount of Da Bomb Beyond Insanity on these chips, and each had our chip. And the only way I can really describe this hot sauce is that it's very Chipotle forward. It's very smoky up front and almost pleasant if you like the flavor. And then it starts to ramp up, and when it's a lingering hot sauce, so it just sticks around. So we're all doubled over in pain, sweating bullets, tears flowing out of our eyes, just huge mess. I should also add that Joel and Wild Bill had been drinking till late in the evening prior, and Bill actually even showed up at the launch and was like, "I am so hungover. This is going to be so bad." So, and I told him, I was like, "No matter what happens, don't puke. Don't do it. it'll be that much worse coming out than it is going in. I'm like, you don't trust me. Don't do it. So, and I've never had that happen from hot sauce in my situation until now. We'll leave that there. So we go on, and Joel decides, he's like, I'm going to get it. I want to try this. How bad is it? And then Andrew just saying, well, I don't want to be the only one not trying it. I'm going to go for it. So all five of us are now doubled over in pain. Delirious, who we thought wasn't like feeling the effects of this at all, is over by his truck questioning his life decisions like, I mean, I've never seen before. I mean, I was genuinely concerned with the guy. If you're listening right now and you do not follow Delirious Angler, go follow that guy right now. He is an absolute champ for this. So we're sitting there, and in the background, you could just hear him, like, heaving. And I'm like, don't do it, man. Fight it. Mind over matter. We're walking around with all I can really describe. It's like if you took the Hale-Bopp Comet and buried it in your abdomen, just burning. Inside at a nuclear reactor. It hurts so badly. We're pounding tortilla chips down just to get some food to kind of absorb it and take care of it. And everybody's drink, all we really had to drink was water because we're freaking idiots. So we're sitting there drinking water, pounding these chips. Things start to subside. We all go our own ways. Everything's fine. I'm feeling great at this point. Now, what I do know that happened was that Bill was on his way home, and I think Joel was right behind him following him, and at some point, Bill pulled over to blow chunks, and he said it was afterwards was the 25 worst minutes of his life ever. It hurt so badly, but I guess afterwards, he felt great. He was fine. My experience was a little bit different. I had like an hour and a half, hour 45 ride back. I'm along Route 2 in Connecticut, just outside of Norwich at this point. And I was feeling great. I had Tenacious D cranking, windows down, feeling awesome. And all of a sudden, something happened in my gut. It just started burning. So, worse than it did at the boat launch. It felt like I was in the movie Alien at the end, when the alien would punch out of the person's chest and you'd see that head kind of like sticking out there. That's what I felt like. I had to pull over and walk laps up and down along the highway while my truck was there just running with the kayak on there and everything else. I go over and I'm like, okay, if it happens, it happens. But then I made a conscious decision that I was just going to fight it the whole way home. I got in the car, readjusted my seat so I was the most comfortable, and then just put cruise control on as fast as I could go. Just made it all the way up 91 North to get home. By the time I hit just north of Hartford, my heartburn and everything had subsided, and I was started to get concerned because I didn't know what I was going to be dealing with later. Now I know why this went wrong. Sean, absolute amateur move right here. I have a really, really bad habit of waking up when I go to fish, especially when I get up at, you know, 3-4 in the morning to get up and get out there early. I get up and I don't eat. I don't eat intentionally. I might have a glass of water and I may periodically have some coffee, but I don't eat when I get out on the water. The first thing I put into an empty stomach was this hot sauce. That was the stupidest move I could have ever made in my life. I paid for it dearly. I think that the video is going to be amazing. It's going to be fantastic. We had a great time. Big shout out to all those guys. Bill, Andrew, D, Joel. We had such a good time out there. A whole lot of fun. Big thanks to Delirious for picking some waters out there. We had the place pretty much to ourselves. It was fantastic. Whole lot of fun. And, you know, I could not have been in better company to be outfished by. The only way it would have been better, Sean, is if you were with us laughing from the safe confines of your truck while we're eating that hot sauce.
Well, I was going to talk a little bit about that.
Go for it.
I wanted to go, and when it came down to when we were discussing the setup of all this, it was back and forth between, you know, Connecticut and Mass.
Yep.
And for me, and I've said this before, I mean, really from April 1st to the end of October every year, every day I'm in a tournament, and most of them, yeah, you know, they're monthlies and they're in Massachusetts. So I saw that coming up, and then when everybody settled on Connecticut, I said, I'm out. I gotta stick around Mass and put some fish in on the board here, which did happen, which was awesome. And for all three of the tournaments. And that's a big thing I'll talk about in a second. But the other thing was, when I knew the stipulations of this, the bomb stuff, you and I know I have some medical dietary restrictions, and that was not happening for me. So I'm like, you know what? I'm going to bow out gracefully on this one. And hopefully, you know, we can get the same group, if not more people, together for a little mass fishing without the internal poisoning going on.
We are we're definitely going to be doing that. There's talk about the next challenge being that the winning team gets to hack the losing team's Instagrams for 24 hours or something like that. And we're
sounds much less painful.
It does. It really does. And I think that the best thing is that next one we're talking Berkshires. Because we want to get Mitch Scase out there, and like, I mean, I think he would have had a blast with this. Absolutely. I think honestly the wheel and choosing teams is awesome. What we did was we took this, it was just this free little app that I found that I put on my phone. It's a wheel you can customize, and I put in everybody's name, and everybody's name actually shows up twice on the wheel so that there's more spots, and a wheel just spins, and once a name comes up, it disappears and can't be selected again. So what we did was the first spin was a captain. The second spin was a captain. Then that first captain got to spin again to select his team. We just alternated back and forth. It's a great way to kind of organize it. And you can't really, you know, it's funny. I knew Delirious had fished this water before. So I was trying to pick his brain in advance. And it dawned on me. I was like, we might not be on the same team. I'm like, he might be sending me in the wrong spot. Who knows? Yeah. You know, pretty interesting. But it was a lot of fun, you know, and I'll tell you what, I really kind of liked getting competitive and having that like super competitive, like because our alerts on the phones would go off. And like there was one point where I think I mentioned before with the Fish Donkey app, how Tim Jackson and I were on the boat and, you know, the donkey sound would go. We look at each other. We're like, son of a bitch. There was one point where I don't know if it was Joel. I think it might have been Joel. Who was kind of within earshot of me, and both of our phones had gone off right at the same time with a notification. We were like, son of a bitch. It went like at the same time. It was fantastic. Oh, but it was a whole lot of fun. We had a good time. I don't know what today is going to yield, and I'm going to leave that at that. I don't know. I'm sure there's going to be fallout, we'll say, from this hot sauce consumption. I'm hoping to avoid it, but we'll see.
On that app you have with the wheel, yep. Do you have the ability, once a name disappears, do you have the ability to put in an icon or a picture or anything like that?
I think it just blacks it out by default.
Because, I mean, there's got to be some way to crowbar some paella in there.
Yeah, that's what I was thinking. A good paella, a good solid wheel of paella, that's a good idea.
I mean, it'll never be that gif that I found of the
actual wheel of paella.
Yeah, the actual wheel of paella. But we can definitely make a close second. A hollow copy.
yeah. There you go. I'll, you know what? I'll bet you if I use the paid version, I'll bet you I could customize the wheel as far as how it looks. I'd be down to make it look like rice and little shrimps and all kinds of good stuff. That would be fantastic.
Mussels, some clams.
Yeah.
Good stuff.
Oh, there we go. Hey, want to give a big shout out to one of our Instagram followers, Real Blonde. Real Blonde set a goal this weekend to get out. She had never caught, I think she had never caught largemouth before. She lives coastal and fishes a lot of salt water, gets a lot of stripers and stuff. But she went out today and she caught, or not today, she went out yesterday with a friend of hers and caught 4 largemouth got to use some new gear. So congrats to you, Real Blonde. Good job. Sent over pics. I'm going to share those as well on our Instagram. Man, it was just a crazy, crazy weekend, man. We got messages coming in from a bunch of people. I want to throw this out there. So today, usually in the intro here, I'll mention who we have coming up in the beef seat. We don't have anybody coming up in the beef seat today. But that actually works out for the best possible situation ever. Because I have a couple of amazing guests. I'm not even going to mention who they are. I don't like to necessarily do that. But we have a couple of amazing guests, so we've had to play with scheduling to kind of work some things out. That stuff we will have coming for you. But what I did instead was I made the decision, something I've wanted to do since I started this podcast, was to utilize Instagram and the poll tool to get people, you know, to either answer questions that I threw out there or to ask me questions. And I got some really, really, really fantastic stuff. So we're going to go through that stuff and share with you some of the questions that I threw out there are questions I ask a lot of my guests. I stayed away from a lot of like the super personal, like, you know, particulars about fishing and just kind of got to it. Some of the new stuff. But I did think of a new interview question, Sean. And I'm actually, I mean, you were one of the first guests I had on the show. So I figure I'm going to throw this one out at you. Okay. You're going out fishing. Let's say you have about an hour-long drive. Whatever time of day, you're by yourself. What are you listening to hype yourself up?
Like, to hype myself
yeah,
up?
Yeah, you can give me like a handful of artists or a handful of genres, anything like that.
All right, you know what I'll tell you? So here's a look into my musical and listening habits. So I listen to, obviously, you know, when you have guests on, you're doing the interviews and I don't hear those.
Yep.
So I'll always listen to our podcast, and that sounds funny, but I'm listening to it just like everybody else. I don't know what, you know, after the intro, I don't know what's happening. And most of the time, because we pre-record all the Sean the Fisherman segments, I don't know what order you're putting them in or yep. whatever. So I usually have a laugh at whatever's going on there. But then I like listening to the interviews that you do. And, you know, when you first started this we were going back and forth, together on texts.
Oh yeah.
I always have, you know, like, day. Hey, that was great. Or,
yep.
or, you know, I try to be your technical advisor and say, hey, when you talked about, I don't know, whatever, an Alabama rig, you know, hey, they're legal in this state, but they're not legal in this. You know, I just throw you some information. You've been really good about, you know, not saying, well, thanks a lot, dickhead. But so our podcast is one. I listen to a couple other podcasts. I don't watch it anymore. It's been a long, long time since I watched it. But, you know, I grew up watching, as a lot of us did in the 80s and into the 90s. I grew up watching pro wrestling. So I do listen to Jim Cornette's podcast.
Yep.
Because wrestling has changed and he is not a happy person about that. And I enjoy listening to him. After that, like, I think the two bands I've really been digging into catalogs lately. So I'll go on a Spotify or honestly, let me inject a complaint here. I know Google owns everything in the world.
Pretty much.
This is not a complaint about Spotify. Actually, Spotify has been the saving grace on this. This is a Google complaint. So Google just is absorbing Google Play, which I loved, into YouTube Music, which I swapped everything over to, and that lasted about a week. So I've moved back to Spotify. It's not a plug for anybody. It's just ease of use for me, and I'm digging back into Spotify. But I mean, musically, lately I've been listening to a band from the Scandinavian region called Feared, a death metal band. That's me. That's what I listen to. Do you know that?
Yep.
What else have I been jamming on? Feared has been big lately. That's where I've been going. Yeah, I think that's about it.
So I listen to podcasts quite a bit as well when I'm going out fishing, and I'll listen to The Bite a lot to get pumped up about fishing. I will, I'll put The Bite on, and when their intro starts, I'm just like, it just makes me smile. I like it, man. So I listen to The Bite a lot. I listen to Tackle Talk every single week. I love it. But I mean, I fish a lot, you know, and sometimes like I will play into like sort of the mood for that day. Sometimes it has to do with like who I'm fishing with. So like when I'm out on my own, if I'm going out, you know, and I'm fishing, you know, just on my own, mm-hmm. I might throw out some like what I would call like punk blues, like Husky Burnett or 10-Foot Polecats or something like that. Or sometimes I just want something like kind of easy and fun. So I'll throw in like a classic rock mix, like the Stones and Zeppelin and get into that. But there's one group that I just feel like is great for fishing, and they're instrumental. They're called Talk, T-A-U-K. And they're sort of like a mix of like if Tool and I don't want to say Fish, but maybe like Mo kind of had like this marriage of sound a little bit. It's really, really great stuff. Some of it's really upbeat and funky. And then Lettuce is another band I like to listen to quite a bit.
But, familiar with Lettuce?
Yeah, I like Lettuce a lot. Yeah, I mean, just...
No, I actually meant the band. I'm actually familiar with them.
Oh, you are?
No,
no shit.
No double entendre there, but, you know, that applies, too.
Most people, when I mention Lettuce, are just like, what? And I'm like,
you know,
they're so good.
You know, you fished with me, and you know that through my cell phone provider, which I'm going to be looking at possibly exploring other avenues down the road here,
yep.
I lose signal somewhere in Granville if I'm going out to, you know, if I'm down the 57 route, up to Shears.
Yep.
I'm losing signal somewhere in Granville, and usually what I will, like the past couple of weeks, I've made sure to, and this is going to make me dated, and I don't care. I will justify it. I bring a CD or two because I still have a CD player in my truck.
Yep.
So lately, What did I grab? I was listening to Anthrax, Sound of White Noise. I haven't listened to that in a while. That was recently in there.
Such a good record.
The self-titled Dallas in Chains with the Tripod Dog on it with, I mean, you know, there's a ton of radio hits on that, but my personal favorite Alice in Chains song is Sludge Factory. And
so good.
You know, the denizens of the Berkshires have been listening to that for a couple of weeks.
Yeah.
What else did I bring? I brought something. And usually I bring something that's a standard and then something that's unusual. If I have CDs with me, like something I just haven't listened to. And, you know, you pick up in a dollar bin somewhere and you're like, oh yeah, there's one or two good songs on there. But, you know what I was listening to? My oldest son is, you know, it's the time, it's not 1993 anymore, is starting to get into a lot of different kinds of rap. And I said, well, you know, when he was younger, he would come with me to a lot of metal shows. I mean, he, for his 10th or 11th birthday, I took him to see Judas Priest and Saxon.
Oh, so, my God. He loved it?
Yeah, he had a blast.
That's awesome.
But now, you know, he's in middle school now, and, oh, my dad listens to metal, and that's not cool. I like rap. I'm like, yeah. All right, that's fine. I said, would you like to listen to some of the rap that I listen to? Because I, you know, while I'm a metalhead and listen to a ton of jam band stuff, which seems contradictory, but whatever. I do have, you know, staples of rap. We grew up in the 90s, man. Gangsta rap.
Everybody had the Chronic. Everyone had the Chronic.
Yeah. Everyone had Black Sunday and everyone had Doggy Style. So, yep. So, you know, I said, well, here, you know, in the late 90s, rap and metal really merged to 99.9% of the time disastrous results.
Yep.
But I said, here's something that I dig that I thought actually they made it work right. And it's Stuck Mojo, if you're familiar with them.
Oh, yeah. Stuck Mojo was a great band. Have you ever seen them live?
I have not. And now they're Fozzy now. So that I will never see them live.
Yeah. Good show. They were great back in the day.
Yeah. So, I mean, it's a niche thing. You know, I don't listen to rap metal often, but I have that disc. And once every 2 to 3 years, it pops out. And I'm like, oh, I forgot about Stuck Mojo, you know. Yep. And nine out of 10 times, I'm listening to some sort of combination of progressive or melodic death metal. But,
yep.
You know, and as far as CDs, my justification for that, I mean, we grew up in that era where, you know, I know vinyl's making a comeback. Did you see that news report the other day about vinyl outselling CDs for the first time since like the early 90s?
Oh yeah. Well, now vinyl's become the cool thing. You know, everybody.
Yeah. So,
yeah.
So I'm a CD guy, because vinyl wears out and CDs do eventually if you leave them in the light, but for the most part, they don't. You've got them for your life.
Yeah.
So, I mean, we grew up, you know, my dad had a vinyl collection, never got into tapes and then jumped right to CDs. So when we were in middle school, tapes were the big thing, and then they kind of got phased into CDs probably around high school, right?
Yeah. Yeah.
You and I graduated the same year.
Yep.
Yeah. So, I mean, my CDs, I'm still conditioned and I still prefer to listen to tracks 1 through X. You know what I mean? Go right through it. And I know things have changed, and a lot of bands will put out a single here, a single there, or put something on, you know, whatever media they're using. But I liken it to, you know, buying a book and just reading one chapter. I don't do that. I read the entire book start to finish, and I do the same thing with CDs.
Yeah.
So, I mean, it doesn't have to be a progressive rock, you know, piece of artwork like Dark Side of the Moon, where you really should listen to it, or Pink Floyd the Wall, where
concept album, and you really,
correct.
Yeah, exactly. Like, and I think that's an art that's kind of disappeared, because now it seems like albums are just collections of individual songs and singles. Somewhere along the line, something changed.
Yeah. Yeah. You know, and it's possibly I would say the internet would probably have the most to do with it, because you're not restricted to that album format anymore. I mean, a lot of metal bands still do it, and a lot of rock bands will still do it, but you know, you don't need to, they do it because their fan base is, you know, I guess older and likes it that way. I don't know. But getting just another music reference, I'm going to crowbar in. You and I had some fun this week with some of the messages I was sending. And this is going to go out to our listeners, because those of you who we run into on the stream banks and at the boat launches and everything, we've been out of Jigs and Big stickers for a week. And Bobby has tasked me with the Jigs and Big sticker purchasing. So I went through, did some research, got a new company, and kind of looked at some of the measurements and said, well, I think this one will be good. Notice I said think. And so we have, I now have a nice, I bought, I made it, I made a small trial run, which was smart. And I got some Jigs and Bigs stickers that are exactly 2 inches across. They're too small to hand out because if you put them on your truck, your boat, whatever, nobody can see them. So they look good. Bobby approved them. And I went back to the drawing board and got them double the size. So stickers are coming. But because of that, I immediately sent you the a couple of videos from Spinal Tap of Spinal Tap ordering the wrong size Stonehenge. And then, you know, things go awry from there. And that's exactly how I felt when I opened up this envelope and I said, oh, shit. But it happens. You know, I've never purchased large amounts of stickers before. And then whatever. It's all good.
You know,
so, yeah, I jacked up the stickers. Sorry, people. If you want little tiny stickers, I'm happy to hand them out. But they're on their way. They've been ordered and they'll be here in I believe a week.
You know, what actually I think could be useful for those stickers is we're in the process of working out details for a monthly giveaway in collaboration with Old Glory Outdoors. No idea exactly what month that's going to launch. We'll probably I'm kind of hoping we can launch it in October. So what I think could be great is, you know, one thing that I want to do with these giveaways is not just do like, here's the item we're going to give this away. I'd like to get a few different things and do like sort of like a care package. And if we can bundle all that together and kind of put our sticker on the envelope when we ship it out or on the box, that's not a bad use for them, because then it shows up on your doorstep and you're just like, oh, snap. Sean the Fisherman and Bobby Roast Beef sent me some swag.
Oh, they'll get used. I'm not worried about that.
Oh, yeah. Didn't you compare them to being like Jigs and Bigs Pogs?
Yeah, they're pugs.
And only those listeners of a certain generation are going to be like nostalgic about that and say, I remember pogs. Actually, yep. I feel like you and I were a little old. Like we were aware of pogs, but there were no fucks given for pogs in our age.
Yeah, I missed the pogs boat.
By a few years.
We had other stuff going on.
Yeah. We were too busy standing in circles kicking koosh balls around. That's what
we did. Well, no, you know. Well, if we're going to take a trip down memory lane here, I mean, we had the toys of the 80s, and then we started maturing right as the 90s hit into our teenage years. And for me, that was where I really went headlong into comic book collecting. That's when the comic book boom was.
Yes.
And
I followed similar, probably not as deep, but similarly along those lines.
Yeah, that lasted for me for decades. And to this point, I still, you know, I sold my collection. It was immense years ago. And I saved a few books that I had signed or whatever. But for the most part, I now go back to Amazon or eBay and buy trade paperbacks with collected stories. You know, like I still to this day, I know there's a lot of good stuff out there in comics. I keep an eye on it, but I don't read anymore. I don't go to the store every week. I haven't bought a new comic book in, man, I don't know, 10 years.
Oh, yeah.
But I still collect those collected editions. Like personally, the 80s, you know, X-Men run by Chris Claremont is still among the best long-term stories ever told. And yeah, I'm still putting that together. So
nice.
It's all good.
Yeah. Well, yeah, that's the thing. Some toys you just never, ever, like when I was in the 90s for me, that's when I really started to get into DJing a lot. And you know, I made it a job. I made it a career that, you know, 30 years later or whatever. I mean, it's, you know, it's now it's at the point I've been doing it for so long and now it is what I do, but it's crazy. Well, what I did. been out DJing in a long time, but you know, that led into hosting game shows and trivia and online stuff, and then now podcasting. So I guess, you know, making the world go around. Pretty much
it. And now you're the host of a fishing podcast who occasionally poisons himself for the entertainment of the listeners.
I hope you people like this shit. I hope you I hope every one of you listening to this show appreciate the things that not only I have done to myself, but the fact that I managed to somehow rope five other fantastic individuals into. There's somebody in the messages last night. So I want to actually go through the messages in my Instagram right now. I started a group of everybody involved, and Sean was a part of this group as well. And I titled it early on. I called it "Fishing is Da Bomb Throwdown." It was everybody who was in there, and I'm going to give a little bit of a play-by-play about how this. Sean chimes in and was like, wow, disappointed I didn't fish with you lunatics, but I'm completely at peace with not setting my innards on fire. That is exactly what went down. Exactly. Unbelievable. What did somebody said something in here, and they said something about, you know, everybody thinks Bobby Roast Beef is just this nice guy that runs a podcast and helps out the fishing community, but well, look at what he does. Look at that sadistic bastard. Oh, here we go. Yeah. Oh, it says, Bobby, you're a bad... This is. Oh, no, this is from you, Sean. Bobby, you're a bad influence. There are innocent New Englanders shitting blood because of what you perceived as fun. To which my reaction was a gif from Bob's Burgers of the youngest daughter doing an evil laugh with a flame, like fire in the background. Oh, my goodness, man. Yeah, and yeah, the GoPro was running the whole time. Just absolutely terrible. Yeah, right here. So Wild Bill goes, everyone thinks Bobby is some nice guy trying to bring the community together. It's just been discovered that you just want to watch the world burn. And by world, I mean, you seriously, the chest pain was the worst. Oh, my goodness. Somebody used the term blood shits a couple of times.
That was me.
Awful. I was, and again, like, I did throw this out there. I'm not some sick bastard. I go, I actually feel really bad about this whole thing. You know, I mean, Bill going and puking his guts out on the side of the road, because that is my worst fear. Like, eating some hot sauce that hot and having it come like that, I don't want to deal with. Fight it to the end. You know, I fought it for the whole drive, but I do appreciate that Bill chimes in and goes, I'm not saying I wouldn't do it again. That is what you call, that's dedication. That is a team player right there. My God.
I think I told you, I related that story. We had gone to Disney a couple of years ago with my parents, the parents and the kids. We went to Epcot during the World Food and Wine Festival. Have you ever had the pleasure?
Oh, yeah.
Yeah. So all these things are listed, and with my, you know, again, restrictions, I had to look at a special menu they had up. So I'm like, okay, well, I can hit like, you know, 10 of the countries. They have stuff I can eat. So I went over and saw, what was it? It was Thailand. They had some seasoned steak and rice. And I said, oh, okay, I can do that. And I went over and I took a bite. And when the first bite was going down, I'm putting the second one in my mouth and I go, oh, something's wrong. This is hot. This is no bullshit hot. I got tears streaming down my face. Yep. I'm reaching for a soda, milk, anything. I'm going, oh my God, my mom is like grabbing me. Now I'm a grown man. My mom's grabbing me going, you're embarrassing me. Stop it. And she said it just loud enough that some stranger 2 feet from us at a table who is crying turns around and goes, lady, he's not fucking kidding. He's crying, streaming. I'm like, yeah, I told you, leave me alone. Let me just pour soda on myself or whatever's going to put out this flame.
It's, you know, and that kind of stuff, it blows my mind that they would serve something that hot, because I work in and out of restaurants and bars all the time. And there's like, you'll see things, restaurants and bars can only push the envelope so much. You know, they have to be cognizant of like people that show up and think I can eat anything spicy in the world. And they might think that the spiciest hot sauce out there is Frank's Red Hot. You know,
yeah,
it is the name of the game is perspective. So they have to kind of play it safe. It surprises me that Disney, like the happiest place on earth, would be like, you know what I mean? They would just give you whatever. Oh man, that's crazy. That's intense. But I'll tell you, Thai cuisine doesn't play around.
Yeah. Well, keep in mind, it's Thailand. There are no rules, Disney or not.
That's true. Oh, yep. Very nice. All right. So do we have anything else to go over? Oh, yeah. No, let's talk about there's some developments with Chronic Trips and the pre-reg is on. Let's go ahead and get right into that.
Yeah. And, you know, and you and I kind of went back and forth on a few things. You know, just so you know, I guess I'm keeping the beef seat warm this week. Right. Is that what's happening? We're going to cover all the loose ends. Well, not all of them, but quite a few loose ends that we have answers to. And we'll knock some of this stuff out. So, yeah. Yeah, well, unless you have to get up, in which case I'll fill, I'll stall, I'll do some tap dancing or something.
Perfect.
So the Chronic Trips, yeah. So pre-reg is up, we're ready to rock. There is going to be a couple of big changes, which are, I think, going to be really positive, okay? The first one, there are two divisions, okay? So there's a sponsors/can athletes division, which you and I will be a part of.
Yep.
And there is a competitors division. So if you're not a sponsor and you're not a can athlete, do not, you know, make sure you look at the divisions. There's a pull down menu when you register and go into the competitors, please. That's number one. Number two, after doing the judging, and I mentioned this during the recap, after doing the judging, Seth and I talked about some sort of standardization for measuring boards. And we came up with using the yellow hog troughs as a minimum. So if you're going to be in this tournament, you can get a hold of those yellow hog troughs on the Fish Donkey website. Okay. They sell the gear there. They're under $20. Please get one. All right. Please, 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 please. That being said, if you don't have one, some of us, myself, yourself, I know, Nelson just gave me his old one. We're any extra ones we have, I will try to get them out so people can, you know, mitigate the cost. So we have a couple that are free. Just contact me. You know, if you're going to be in the tournament and once you register, send myself an email, send Seth an email, and it's first come, first serve. I know one of them's already reserved, so I think we're down to two, but I just want to, you know, make sure that everyone is doing or using the same boards. Cause it was not an easy task to judge some of those fish last tournament. And I saw what Seth was up against, and yeah, if we can standardize that, it's going to be better. Now, here's what I do want to say. Anybody who's looking at fishing beyond chronic trips competitively, the industry is shifting, whether it's this year or next year, those Ketch, spelled K-E-T-C-H, boards are going to be the industry standards. The hog troughs are bendable. They break. They're not perfect. And on top of that, if you use those, you have to darken in the lines, every one of the lines with a black permanent magic marker. So if you're thinking about competitive fishing, you know, in the coming years, bass fishing or whatever, out of a kayak, out of anything that uses measurement-based judging system, excuse me, you might want to just go ahead and jump straight to the Ketch. That's just advice. And that way you're not spending $20 on a hog trough. And then all of a sudden, oh, I want to fish something else. And they don't allow the hog trough. Now you got to pony up a minimum of $30 for a Ketch, unless the organization you're with has some sort of a discount. So think before you buy. That's my advice. But please have a hog trough at the bare minimum for the October tournament. So the next item on the list, Bobby and I are asking, you and I are asking all of our listeners for advice. Okay. I'm going to throw the problem up there, and I want to hear legitimate answers to this. And I want a what and a why. All right. So there's your criteria, folks. Bobby and I fish cold water. I particularly fish extremely cold water. I don't mean cold water as in we're in the north and it's not 85 degrees by April. I mean, I go out in December. If there's no ice,
if it's open, water, he's out there.
I will fish it. So sometimes the air temperature is actually colder than the water. So I'll go out and it'll be, you know, 40 degree water and the air temperature will be 38, yep. You know, with wind. It's nuts. So over the years, I have tried like a number of different, clothing to try and keep myself warm and safe. So not just stuff that'll keep you warm, because anybody can put on any number of, you know, for example, Carhartt makes a lot of great cold weather products, right? Any ski gear, stuff like that. But if I go in the water, I'm sinking like a rock. So like this spring, and you know, and I found out later what the problem was, underneath my rain gear, underneath my outer layer of clothing, I was wearing a wetsuit.
Yep.
A Farmer John wetsuit, because if I go in the water, it'll keep it'll keep you alive for a few minutes if you're in 40 degree water, 38 degree water, whatever. But that, with sitting in a kayak for sometimes, you know, 5, 6, 7, 8 hours, if not more, man, that Farmer John beat the crap out of my shoulders. Cause then I found out later that with Farmer John's, if you do that, they tend to pull your body forward because it's an elastic material. You're fighting it the whole time.
Yep.
Dry suits, I have no experience with, but they're incredibly expensive. So what I have worn in the past few years was, again, a Carhartt bib that I got honestly issued to me when I was, you know, working federally, and a pair of boots that I still wear that are, you know, stones. If I go in, they're bringing me down. And then usually, like a couple layers of sweatshirts, Under Armour stuff, whatever, but I'm looking for a light, comfortable cold weather fishing, you know, gear outfit that I'm going to be able to move around with freely. I mean, any input is welcome, because I'm on, like I said, take number three, and I'm not finding an answer. And this has been 15 years of doing this. So any input anybody has, if you fish cold water, throw it our way, please. We'd love to hear it. We discussed what the email address, right? So yeah. Go ahead and
best way to do it. Shoot us an email with the what. Even if you want to provide links, if there's something you've used and you've got a reason why you think it works so well, you can give us a link too. If it's something that's that good or a product description, email us at jigsandbigs413@gmail.com or visit our website jigsandbigs.com and just use the contact form there. Send that over. This way we can kind of get an ongoing dialogue about this stuff. And there's talk that we may do a live on both Facebook and YouTube shortly and tackle this topic or just bring it right on the podcast. If we end up doing this live, it'll probably double on the podcast as well. But it'll be out there. And it's something that, a lot of anglers need to be concerned with, mainly if you're, going out, especially if you're going out in a kayak where you're that close to the level of the water, where the potential of, getting wet, if nothing else, even if you don't go over, but the potential of getting wet is there. And I mean, let's be honest, you want to make sure that you're not just warm and comfortable, but also safe. The last thing you want to happen is you end up at the bottom of a lake because the things that you were wearing are now, instead of, keeping you safe and warm, they're now providing you with a weight to drag you down to the bottom. So you gotta, keep all this stuff in mind. So it's definitely something to think about. I'm going to be this year, because I have no idea going into this, and I still don't feel safe at a certain point. If I can't stand in that water barefoot to get into my kayak, I'm not going out. I'll be bake fishing throughout those periods of time. It's just for my own safety, until I have some stuff lined up and the confidence to be able to launch without, having to worry about, getting soaked. Even, think about it, Sean. When you're out there, those little drips from your paddle periodically and the water's that cold, that's why you need the rain gear. If you're out there and you're wearing a pair of jeans, even if you're wearing thermal underwear underneath or something like that, or another layer, if that stuff gets wet, it's basically going to be open. You're basically opening up yourself to all the elements at that point.
Yeah, and during extremely cold weather, I'll wear neoprene gloves.
Yep.
2 millimeter, 3 millimeter, whatever. I'll wear those gloves, and they help out quite a bit. But yeah, you're right. You bring that paddle up. If you take the wrong arm angle and one drop goes down that sleeve, even though on my rain gear, I have a Velcro wrist wrap. So you can actually seal it pretty well up against the gloves.
Yep.
It's not watertight. That goes down your elbow. My God, it's miserable.
Oh yeah.
Especially if it happens right when you get out there and then you've got, I think I've said it on the podcast before. My rule of thumb is during the cold months, when the West is pretty much locked up and you can't fish, due to, skim ice, and you can't ice fish because you'll go through it.
Yep.
Usually Cape Cod stays open. Yeah, I think every month, but like February, usually late January through February, Cape Cod has skim ice and you're screwed. But my rule of thumb is I will drive the 2.5 hours out there and then drive the 2.5 hours back as long as I fish for the 5 hours. Yeah. So I fish as long as I drive. And that's just in a day. I'll leave my house at whatever, 7, 8 o'clock in the morning, get out there for mid morning, try to fish through to dusk. Cause especially in the winter, I find that, a dusk bite is always better because that's the warmest point of the water.
Yeah.
So the warmest point of the day, that the water's been warming up all day, and then you can see it drop. It's as soon as the sun goes down, that water drops. Yep. But yeah, I'll do that. And over the past few years, I've done, I have some pictures. I think I took them off Facebook, but me and some of my high school buddies would meet up out there and bring a grill, and we'd fish until 5 o'clock, until it got dark. And then, somebody would stop and get some fresh scallops or something, and we'd fire that up on the grill at the truck side. We made an event out of it. But the bottom line is I really want to find something that's comfortable, not only for me, but something I can pass along to everyone, saying, hey, if you're going to go out in these temperatures and you're going to, honestly, there's no other way to put it. If you're going to risk your life to fish, minimize that risk. So let's see what we can do.
Oh, absolutely. No.
You have your homework.
Yeah, I think that's, and if you have something that you can send out to us, then, let us know. And we'll obviously give you a shout out on the show when we mention it, and like Sean said, a what and then a why. Why are you choosing that? That goes a long way to give us some insight as to, what it is that you're using and the reasons behind it. So that's really, really important. Was there anything else, Sean, that we wanted to mention?
I just hammer that point home. If anybody is going to do this, I mean, the big thing to keep in mind, and I'm not going to be rude about it. I'm going to appreciate everybody's input, but I don't want to get input from somebody that didn't consider, you know, the two things to consider is keeping the occupant of a kayak or a boat or whatever warm and dry when out of the water and not dead
in the water.
You go into the water.
Yep.
You know what I mean? So dry, that's, you know, that's where you have to start thinking like dry suits, but what are you going to wear underneath a dry suit? I don't know. Like, again, I want to see what everyone else has to say.
Yeah, no. I think that's great. Well, if we don't have anything else to go, I think this is a good spot right here. We'll throw to our little mid break.
Hold on. Throw the brakes on. You forgot the most important thing. I was building to this. This was a build. This was a slow burn.
It was a slow burn. Okay.
Yeah. So as you know, we'll let this out. We recorded what looks to be, for the time being, the last bunch of Sean the Fisherman stories.
Yes.
There is a sub theme running through them, and it doesn't look like we're going to record anymore for the foreseeable future unless, you know, stupid shit happens. So I'll probably have another one next week. Yeah. Probably have another one going next week. But so we've recorded all those, and I wanted to open the channels up to do like an AMA and ask me anything. Try to keep it fishing related, folks. I want to provide as many fun stories as I can, but I don't want to get into like, you know, past or current illegalities. Sexual stuff is great. We all like talking about sex, but I don't want to talk about it on a podcast.
Okay.
You know, yeah, I'd like to open that up. If, you know, again, use the Jigs and Bigs email. What is it? Jigsandbigs413@gmail.com, right?
Yep. Jigsandbigs413@gmail.com. Or you can send that over through the contact form at jigsandbigs.com as well. And we'll get right back to you. And we'll filter all that stuff in there. I like to think of this, Sean, as like an evolution of Sean the Fisherman of the segment. It's gone from sharing these stories to, I mean, should I mention what that, I guess we'll call it a mini series, what this is?
I don't know, because I think if we do, it steals the thunder from all right. That first intro. Well, that we'll first say, intro, I'm so excited.
That's true. We'll just say that this is like a little mini series, a little focal point, if you will, of Sean the Fisherman on a very specific entity that exists in the world. I think that's the best way to surmise it. So we're going to go for this. That's going to carry on for a number of weeks. And then, while that's running, we'd like to start putting together some elements here that are sort of like, so if you have a tip or a trick that you're looking for from Sean the Fisherman, this is a great way to look at it. If you're looking at like buying your first kayak and you want to know like something like that, I mean, this is a great, great way to do. If you want to know how to make a delicious paella, it's also a great resource to submit your question to Sean the Fisherman so he can share his recipes, whether they're a paella, a crazy arepa, you name it. I mean, you know, any hot sauce questions you can direct to either myself or Wild Bill from Hookside Hoodlums.
Yeah, until you guys are dead from eating too many hot sauces, but that's fine.
I think we're going to live forever. I'm taking a different spin.
It is definitely a reinvention of Sean the Fisherman, but
– yeah.
I was honestly looking at this as like, well, I've told the stories I can remember. Somebody's going to ask something. I'm going to go, oh, yeah. And I'm going to have like five more. Yep.
I kind of figured was going to happen. It would be a nice little offshoot.
Yeah, they're going to jog my memory. We're old hippies. It happens.
Very nice.
You know? Yeah. So we'll run with that and see how it goes. But yeah, send me some questions, folks. I'm happy to answer stuff. And, you know, with the fishing tips and stuff, the blog is going to eventually come along a little more with the website. I have been working on a couple other things, but I'm honestly right now I'm trying to figure out the spacing and the timing of how to put up these blog posts so that, you know, I've been really religiously doing the fishing report, and I just want to make sure that works with both the podcast posting and the report. So I'll figure it out. I don't want to drop something on the weekend and then somebody sees it on like a Tuesday when they could have used it that weekend. You know what I mean?
Exactly.
So I'll figure it out. But I have stuff in the works. It's just going to be a lot of information. I thought about this because I have sent it out to fishermen in the past. I'll probably put a copy, obviously, you know, pretty sanitized because I don't want people knowing exactly where I fish, what I'm catching, or what I'm catching them on. But of my fishing log.
Yeah.
I developed it. It's just an Excel sheet, but it has the information that I put on there and probably a couple of pictures of, you know, my little, you know, I keep an all weather notebook with me. And every time I catch a fish, the fish goes back in the water and I am writing feverishly for about 30 seconds or whatever. Not even that. And
it's sort of
honestly,
I got to share something that I've, because there's a lot of times where we'll be out fishing, and when we fish a lot, we fish, we just bullshit back and forth. So I may be, you know, taking a cast and he's releasing a fish, because Sean catches way more fish than most other humans. And he goes over and he'll start writing. And in my head, if any of our listeners have watched the Tonight Show in the last handful of years, the thank you note segment, that piano music plays in my background. Thank you, fish, for chomping at my floating Rapala. And I mean, something like that. Like, in my mind, that's kind of what it is. It's like, oh, Sean's doing his thank you notes now. Okay, great.
No.
Yeah. No, it's actually a really good idea.
Yeah, so I'll post that up at some point. I'll sanitize it. Like I said, I've given that out a couple of times. It's a great tool. I would direct that as the number one thing to making me a better fisherman over the past, well, it's on year 11 now, without a doubt. It's just being honest. It's not... nobody sees my log. You know, I might show it to you every once. Gross. I might show it to you every once in a while and say, hey, check this out. Like, in particular, I don't think I mentioned, but for a great statistical thing, and again, with my video game background and current playing habits, which aren't much, but I still play every now and again.
Yep.
I like high scores, man. I like topping myself. I like giving myself a baseline to go up against. So like, Since I retired from the military the past 2 years, I've had more weekends free. So the past 2 years, I can say after this weekend, past 2 years, I have caught 500 plus largemouth in a year.
That's insanity. I mean, so that is, wow.
Last year was, and I don't know how that sits. I don't know if that's good against a quote unquote pro angler. I don't know. I'm the only person I know who does this religiously.
Yeah. You know what I mean? A lot of people, they just don't.
Yeah, I don't know if that's good. It could be bad. I don't know. But, like, I know last year I ended up with 515, and this year, as of yesterday, I went 507. So I'm going to top 515 unless, I, you know, something extraordinary happens where I can't fish anymore or yep. whatever. But, it's neat to see. My wife is an Excel expert, so she's given me a lot of pointers and tips on, like, what I want to do with graphs and this and that and the other thing. Yeah, my breakdowns are pretty nuts. It's neat to see. And all it does is improve my efficiency on the water.
Yeah.
I don't know what anyone else would use it for, but and it improves me, you know, honestly, you know, because it's a question every week, it helps me avoid going into a tackle retailer and buying a lure that's designed to catch a fisherman, because
that's true too. You know what's performing, and you've got the proof and the data to back it up.
Exactly. That doesn't mean I don't try new things. You know, yeah. I've got an order in right now with Joe at Old Glory for a Spro Rat. I've been watching the damage you've been doing with Spro Rats. And I said, well, I got to give that a run.
I have to replace
the
tail.
One particular color I want is back ordered up the wazoo all over the country, if not the world. But mm-hmm. That's fine. We'll get that. And then my plastics, there's a certain kind of plastic that, you know, I have a ton of success with that. I've got, I don't know. I think I just told Joe, screw it. Give me 20 bags of the shit.
Yeah.
You know, we're just waiting. So, but you know, I know those plastics work over and over and over again, tried and true. And yeah, so it helps. But it's being honest. Like if you go out and you get skunked, and if you go out and you catch 1 3-inch bluegill, I put that 3-inch bluegill in there because, oh, when you look over the course of time, if you say, hey, well, hey, I've been using give me a lure, small lure.
Like a small lure,
anything.
I don't know. We'll say a drop shot with a Sakoshi bug.
Okay, I would never use that.
I know. I'm just thinking of something that maybe a smaller fish that isn't necessarily desirable might eat.
So let's say you've been buying those and you're using them, and whenever you drop shot them, all you're getting is 7-inch. Or am I aiming for something else and that's what's taking them? Maybe you have 7-inch perch and like a, you know, 1 20-inch largemouth, you know, a 5-pounder. You got to decide on those things. Like one of the things we mentioned on the first podcast, when I was talking about this log, one of the biggest decisions I had to make when I finally evaluated my data after 3 years was I had like 5 or 6 fish on chatterbaits, but they were all bigger than 2 pounds. So what do I do? I'm like, well, I'll keep them in the box and keep rolling. And I'm lucky I did, because I've caught many, many larger fish on chatterbaits since then, you know? So there's an example.
Yeah. So you guys definitely jump on all that stuff. Contact us with either gear recommendations for cold weather, ask Sean anything type stuff, and do all that at jigsandbigs413.com or at the contact page at jigsandbigs.com. Folks, we're going to take a short break. We're going to come back and dive into the Instagram details that we have for you, and we're going to go ahead and talk about what we've kind of interviewed a lot of our followers over there. We're going to take a look at some of their responses to questions I asked, and then answer some of the questions that they asked me. So we'll be back after this. Don't go too far.
Sean. Sean. Sean.
Hey, everybody, this is Sean the Fisherman with my weekly tale. This is a good one this week, a really memorable experience I had. My wife's family is pretty much scattered all over the country. So every couple of years, they'll get together, big family reunion. A couple of years ago, we did this at Hilton Head in South Carolina. And on the 4th of July, we were lucky enough to get a shark charter in the afternoon. So I took my three brother-in-laws and my two sons and myself, got on the boat. And as the sun was setting, we each pulled in a shark. I also pulled in a stingray, had a blast doing so. And then unfortunately, we're stopped by the harbor master on the way back into the harbor. And we got to watch the fireworks from underneath them, which was awesome because there was a fireworks barge. And then with the traffic at the dock, once we got there, we sat down in a Mexican cantina where the house band that was covering all sorts of tunes covered a song that's been played numerous times by the Grateful Dead and all sorts of Grateful Dead spinoff bands over the years, called Not Fade Away. I believe it's a Chuck Berry song. And we sat there, and I'll always remember that, us sitting down, waiting for the traffic to clear, jamming on Not Fade Away, and talking about the adventure we just had. Very memorable 4th of July. I'm Sean the Fisherman. Have a good week.
Alrighty, folks, here we are. We're back after that quick break. What we've got now is typically in this spot of the show, you would have our interview segment. We'd have a guest. They'd be in the beef seat. I'd be interviewing them about their fishing particulars and things. And unfortunately, I think I had mentioned this earlier, we had some, we had some scheduling conflicts. I kind of delayed things a little bit for this week's podcast, but I looked at that as not so much like something to complain about, but a great little opportunity to do something I've wanted to do since we launched this podcast. And honestly, the only reason why I have not done that is simply based on the fact that we were just starting out and I didn't have the audience necessarily, the following, to go ahead and throw some questions out there and get some responses back and sort of actually turn it into something really, really good. And I think we have something great for you. So let's go ahead and jump on in here and discuss what we have here. So the first question is, so what I had done was this. I had on my Instagram story for Jigs and Bigs, I had posted something saying that essentially due to scheduling conflicts that had appeared, I wasn't going to have a guest on and that I was going to interview anybody who wanted to take part by answering the questions in the poll questions that would follow along in my storyline. And you guys reached out in droves. Now, I did periodically go back and screenshot some of the responses that were there. So that I can go over them and talk about what they are. So here we go. So the first question that's out there is, what's on your bucket list for places to fish? Where do you want to go out there and fish? And we got Fishing with Porter responded by saying Florida for some peacock bass, which is awesome. Drop Shotters, I love the handle, by the way, is Lake, I think this is Okeechobee. Pockets Grigio, local boy, Western Mass, says anywhere in Japan. That's pretty lofty. I like that one. Barramundi Gorge from Sean Sejerp or Sherp or Sierp, I guess. We've got Ryan William with three M's at the end, says he would love to fish in the Bahamas. I can't say I disagree. I think that's a great idea. CT Blue Line Outdoors responded, a lake in South Africa. That's an interesting one. We got Mass Homegrown 69, one of the competitors, I believe, from our Chronic Trips bi-monthly tournament, said Okeechobee. I expected to see a whole lot of Okeechobee in there. So Mass Homegrown 69 says Okeechobee. We got Hayes Fishing. Hayes Fishing, that's Andrew Hayes, the host of Tackle Talk podcast, says West Palm Beach for peacock bass. I can't complain about that, man. That's a great, great spot to visit. Absolutely. I mean, fishing or otherwise, make it a nice long trip. And then we have Hole in the Wall Cultivation said Alaska. Man, yeah, I could definitely see that. I think visiting Alaska as the last great frontier is an amazing thing. Absolutely. And like salmon fishing especially is amazing up there. We've got Trailbreaker 747. We know who that is. That's Berkshire's Brett. Chimed in and said, anywhere in the upper Midwest or central Canada for pike. He likes the toothy critters. He likes those. Anywhere upper Midwest, central Canada for pike. I could get into that. RR Outdoors says, river in the Rockies. Who do we have up next? Matagorda Bay from Bass Attack 05. We got Tad Speedy 514 says clear, crystal clear creeks for smallies. Hunter 1205 Schultz says he wants to go to Lake Fork. Lake Erie for Reed Pennington 15. We got Lake Bacharach in Mexico for RL Denidos. Montana for Stand the Taco 1113. I'm actually going to be fishing in Montana. I have a cousin who is getting married, and we at this point can't figure out why Montana is the state they decided to do it in, but I don't care. We're going to go have a great time, take an extended stay, and I'm going to do some fishing in Montana. And what else do we have here? Oh, here we get into some interesting ones here. So Western Mass Bass, our homie Adam Laxton reaches out and says Lake Fork, Lake Texicoma, and Chickamauga. All three. Those are, I think, definitely on anybody's like top three who follows any kind of professional tour fishermen as far as tournament anglers. Lake Fork from the Sangling. We've got Lake Fork and Okeechobee from Albert Rock 2000. Clearwater, anywhere in the sea, and a big lake from Bryant 899, Amazon, and all of Europe. I just want to take on like a bass from all over, even if it's just the dink. That is from Bassin Assassin 74. Bassin Assassin sounds like the perfect vanity plate. Like, it's too many letters, but I kind of love the way it goes. Bassin Assassin. We've got Lake Comodoro, Clear Lake, Lake Fork, and Lake Okeechobee. Those all come from Kenny Goes Outdoors. Paul Pavlovsky, 33, says he just wants to fish in the ocean. There's a lot of it. There's a whole hell of a lot of it. I'd like to take my kids to St. Petersburg, Florida, to fish where my grandpa took me. That's from Black Duck Fishing. Florida or the Amazon from Steven Dream Brogio. We've got B. Smuda. B. Smuda says he wants to fish Bondi's Island. Rumor is that they have some of the best brown trout in Bondi's Island that you can get. Absolutely. As a matter of fact, I don't know. I probably shouldn't have put that on the podcast, but Mark Huard, that might be where I go to take your brown trout record. That might be where it is.
The brown trout that count for the contest have gills and fins, just so you're aware.
You never know what you're going to find at Bondi's. That's all I'm going to say. The world is a carousel of color. Well, we've got Jay Grunig 01 says salmon in Alaska. Salmon is the big one in Alaska. Absolutely. Amazon for Under Yakker. Do we have any more after that? So that about, oh no, I think we have one more page of places where you would want to fish.
While you're looking for that, what's yours?
Mine, honestly, I have to say for me, it's Champlain. It really is. Like I'm setting the bar relatively low, you know, as far as locale. Like that's, there's just, it's the Champlain smallies. That's the big draw for me. What about you, Sean? You've had the opportunity to fish a handful of spots in the country.
I don't know, man. I like little ponds that are untouched. I'd rather sit for days on a small body of water and cut the place to pieces than
go to a larger
body of water. I mean, 20 to 50 acres, I love.
I love little ponds.
Yeah, I mean, I feel like they're definitely more attainable as far as, like, you can, I mean, you could spend a lifetime with some of these large bodies of water and only unlock certain parts of it. You know what I mean? But I think that's sort of the appeal for some of that is the fact that it really does kind of feel like the vast unknown. But I am with you, like, as far as especially fishing like day to day or just for a day, like if I'm going to go to a larger body of water, like if I was to ever go to Chickamauga or Lake Fork, I'd 100% be going with a guide. 100%, because it's about the experience at that point, which will lead into one of these other questions. Some of the other options, this is the last page that I've got here, is Lake St. Clair from J. Retchless 23 says Lake St. Clair. I think that's the first time that's popped up. The ocean, someone says, what is it? Cam Holston Fishing says, the ocean, I've always wanted to go deep sea fishing. You absolutely should just do it. Just jump on a charter sometime. Give it a go. If you're nearby the coast, just absolutely. I think it's something everybody should do. This is another one. The Great Lakes from Mashu Dakashu. The Great Lakes, I think there is some amazing, like those are like absolutely majestic bodies of water. There was a video series that Alex Perrick, AP Bassin, had done recently where he took his new boat out on, was it Lake Michigan? I think it was Lake Michigan. And he basically did the entire coastline on this entire trip. And it was just amazing. I'm like, that is, it really does. It feels it's like the great unknown out there. Very, very cool. West Coast Lakes, Okeechobee, Rayburn, El Salto. That's from Mike Birch Outdoors. Mexico, Indiana, and Texas from Sparky True Nibbler Lipper. True Nibbler Lipper.
Yeah, I see his stuff on Instagram all the time. I'm wondering if there's like a collaboration in the works between our establishment and his and our shared love
of nibblers or disdain
or hate of nibblers, whatever. But Sparky, reach out to us,
Sparky. Absolutely, the Nibbler Ripper. I feel like that's a title I should wear, the Nibbler Ripper.
That just smells like some sort of a day long nibbler contest where anything over 14 inches doesn't count. A reverse lunker something or other. Well, I don't know. Sparky, come on. Let's go. We got some nibblers to catch.
We can make this happen. Oh, wow. That's a great idea. And then our last one is from Rachel Deckel. She says, the Florida Keys. And absolutely right. Man, my parents used to vacation in the Keys all the time. And, yeah, that's a great place to be just in general. But, yeah, the Florida Keys for sure. In fact, I think the Keys are one of the spots that Joe from Old Glory Outdoors had mentioned in one of his stories was actually out in the Keys. I got to make that happen sometime. That screams to me that it needs to happen. All right.
Wasn't Joe saying he was fishing not only the Keys but canals in the Florida area too? I think he covered both.
Yeah, I think he mentioned he was living like when he grew up, like he was fairly young in the Tampa area, and I know they have a lot of freshwater canals that go all over there. So this is one of the questions that got tons of answers, and it's one of the newest questions I've added to the mix. It was basically like, who's on your list, like your top people that you would like to go out and fish with? And there were a ton of answers here, from like, you know, some real obvious ones to some that were kind of surprising to some that were like, you know, had like reasons, like more sentimental reasons for them. Very, very cool. Let's go ahead and jump right into those. So we had...
Why don't you start with me?
We can do that. Let's start with you, Sean. Who is on your short list of people you want to fish with?
Les Claypool. I would love to fish. That would be so rad. It would be bizarre, I'm sure.
Oh, yeah.
I can only imagine the path of the conversation that would take place. But, my God, would I love to fish with Les Claypool. That would be awesome.
Oh, yeah. I could definitely see that. I could definitely see how that would be, like, absolutely out of this freaking world.
Yep.
Yeah. Yeah. He is something else, too. No, that is awesome. I don't know. I'm not sure really who I would like to fish with at this point, honestly. I mean, the issue is with me, the list is so long because we have a lot of guests and a lot of people that have hit me up saying that they want to fish, and they're absolutely on that list. But let's go ahead and dive into what we have here. So Western Mass Bass reaches out and says Mark Daniels Jr., Jacob Wheeler, and Dustin Connell. Under Yacker reaches out and says my dad, Chesty Puller, at George Washington. George Washington, really? I heard he tears it up at the Delaware.
Cherry trees and largemouth. That's a fun day.
It really is. It really is. Charlie Moore, Mike Iaconelli, and Bill Dance. That comes from Hard Bodies Von Rotz. Hardbodies.vonrotz on Instagram. Charlie Moore. Now, somebody once had messaged our podcast and said, "Are you Charlie Moore?" And I just had to kind of chuckle. I mean, I'm like, no. I don't know. I don't think we sound alike. Do we?
No, well, I mean, the obvious answer to that is, because Charlie, I believe, has a somewhat Bostonian accent. Am I correct in that?
I think it's relatively slight, if any at all. I think it's fairly slight.
Well, the obvious answer is a Jerky Boys reference, and that's simply, did you recognize the voice?
There you go. There you go. Let's see. Where were we? So it's Charlie Moore. Okay, another one for Bill Dance. This one comes from Stephen D'Ambrosio. Says Bill Dance, Harrison Ford, and this one I like, Adam Sandler. Okay, that could be awesome and hilarious. I wonder if Harrison Ford is better at fishing than flying planes.
Ooh.
I know, it's terrible. Ooh. Maybe you shouldn't let him take the controls of the boat. Yo. He might pull a Bobby Roast Beef if if you're a patron over at our Patreon page, you would know what the hell I'm talking about. Let's see, we got Wild Bill chimed in here, says fishing with grubs, Dustin Connell, and Lake Fork guy, LFG. We've got Black Duck Fishing, says Stephen King, my grandpa and my son. That's awesome. That's a great lineup right there. Fishing up in Maine is great. Makes it nice and convenient for Mr. King. We got another one for Bill Dance. This one includes Robert Turkola, Lunkers TV, and Corey Johnston. That goes from Kenny Goes Outdoors. Bass and Assassin 74 says he would like to fish with Roland Martin and my grandfather, as well as Jimmy Houston. That sounds like it could be one hell of a trip. We got Ricky C76 says John B. Perrick and Brandon P. Bryant 899 says my dad, my grandpa, and catch 'em all fishing. My grandfather, Bill Dance, and Roland Martin. That's all from Albert Rock 2000. We've got Emriv says Bill Dance, Charlie Moore, and Jigs and Biggs. We even got a plug. Ooh, in there. That's crazy. Now, this one I expected to see more of. Fishing with Becca commented here. She says Mike Iaconelli, Sadie Crowell, and Jeremy Wade. I expected to see a lot more Jeremy Wade in here. Because the guy is an icon. He's amazing.
You know who else we haven't heard? Maybe I don't know, are we reaching a younger crowd? We haven't heard any Kevin Van Dam yet.
Oh, I think we have some KVD coming up. I think so.
Okay.
Yeah.
And real quick, I just want to interlude because you mentioned you mentioned Jimmy Houston a second ago. So as you know, I used to go to Oklahoma City quite a bit for work, and I landed at Will Rogers Airport, went to go get my luggage, and who's standing there across the carousel? I'm staring at him. I'm like, is that Jimmy Houston? I'm like staring at him like, it's got to be Jimmy Houston. It's got to be. And he got his bag and got the hell out of there real quick. And when I eventually got over to my buddy's house in Oklahoma City, I had said, hey, I think I just saw Jimmy Houston at the airport. He goes, yeah, he's got a house out here, so he probably did. I said, oh, well, that's cool. I just saw Jimmy Houston at the airport. So,
that's crazy, man.
Yeah, it was weird.
Definitely one of those situations where you're like, shit, I wish I would have freaking said hello or, you know, acknowledged him somehow, but.
Well, yeah, but I didn't know. I wasn't expecting his
money. Yeah.
So, he grabbed his shit and left.
He's like a doppelganger, and he's like, God damn, who is this Jimmy Houston guy? People keep asking me, or my name's not Jimmy, it's Alfred or some shit. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
Reed Pennington jumps in. He says Jacob Wheeler, Roland Martin, and Scott Martin. We've got Hunter 1205 Schultz as Jacob Wheeler, fishing with Flair and Lake Fork guy. I'd like to fish with LFG. I think that would be, I have to say, I think I would learn a shit ton fishing with that guy. And that's pretty awesome. Congratulations too, by the way, fishing with Flair. Just married his longtime girlfriend this last weekend. And then there's Lake Rayburn. I think that was entered in the wrong spot. That's from Logan Sully 26. Tad Speedy 514 says Jimmy Houston, Bill Dance, and my grandpa that died 2 weeks ago. That sucks, man. Oh. I'm sorry for you, man. That really does suck. Up next, we've got Jaden Witkowski. Jaden wants to fish with KVD, Kevin Van Dam, Ott Defoe, and Justin Lucas. And the last, I told you there was a lot of these. R&R Outdoors says, my great-grandpa, Jesus, and Jacob Wheeler. A lot of Jacob Wheelers in there. A whole lot of Jacob Wheelers. We got
a surprise. That's the first Jesus. He did fish. That is true.
It's true. But I mean, it's not like he needed a boat.
No.
You know what I mean? It's not like
thinking about that might be the most intriguing answer yet. Cause I mean, there's a lot of possibilities there. That's cool.
I don't
good
know.
Answer.
I might have to DQ him from a tournament though. If it was a tournament situation, just cause the loaves and the fishes and stuff, you know.
Well, we didn't say fish competitively against, our Lord and Savior. They said fish with. That's a pretty good answer.
Fair enough. No, it is. Like, that classic question of, like, so you're having a dinner party. You've got X amount of seats. Fill those with people living or dead you would like to have there at your dinner party. And that comes up a lot. And people are just like, oh, yeah, Elvis and Jesus and blah, blah, blah. You know, just like all these, dead folks or, just icons. So I'm with you. I'm a little surprised we haven't heard more out of that one.
I think the funniest thing would be, it would have to be like exasperated Jesus from South Park, because whoever's in the boat would be like, hey, Jesus, look, JC, I'm out of cigarettes. And there's going to be like an eye roll and a sigh, and then bam, there's a carton.
Yeah. An eye roll and a sigh. Oh my God. Oh, I love it. I love it. Rebel Soldier 1 says Kendall Gray and John B. We've got Mass Homegrown 69 says Brian Kirchhill, Kevin Van Dam again, and Ish Monroe. I'd love to fish with Ish.
Let me interject. I'm going to interject with ridiculous stories every now and again.
Go for it.
So the Ish Monroe, that's another name we haven't heard pop up.
Yeah.
So I want to give Ish credit on something, on the way that I fish. So if those of us that remember, this was years ago, they stopped. Well, my kids were alive. So I have to think, that sounds horrible. My kids were alive. My kids had already been born. The last time I took, I went to the Worcester Fishing Show. That thing stopped happening, about 8 or 9 years ago, I think.
Yeah, I think so.
Well, I went, oh boy, what year was it? Whatever. I went a long time ago and Ish Monroe was a speaker there.
Mm-hmm.
So he's up with the headset on, sitting on top of that big tractor trailer with a fish tank in it. And he's just lobbing a tube or whatever into the tank and letting bass inhale it. There wasn't even a hook on it as he's talking. And he talked about simplifying the way you fish. He related a story about going to a tournament and he's unloading box after box after box of lures and plastic and gears and gear and everything. And some other, I forgot the other pro fisherman that was, loading his boat next to him. And Ish had said, well, where's all your stuff? And he's like, I got it right here. And he held up like one tackle bag and one tackle box. And Ish said he was floored, but he said the guy had said something to, and I'm paraphrasing, I use what brought me to the dance. I know what I'm comfortable with and I use it and I live and die with it. And Ish said that affected him. And when he told that story, I was like, wow, that's a really good thing to keep in mind. And that's kind of what I base all my fishing on. You've seen the amount of gear I bring out. It's pretty minimal.
Oh yeah. Absolutely. And it's funny because I have recently started to kind of adopt the same thing, especially regardless of if it's bank angling or in the kayak, I try to have a pre-planned box of things for those conditions. And sometimes I'm putting that box together when I see the water, like if it's a fresh body of water I haven't seen before, I'll have my big backpack of gear. And then that one box that I'll put on the kayak or throw in my day bag that I'll carry on my back, it'll just be that one box plus the soft plastics that I know I can count on and give me the most options. And I just try to streamline it down. And I find that honestly, it works really, really well that way. I of course have a separate, box for like terminal tackle. So I've got options to play with that stuff. But it's like, no, I agree. I think that there's definitely something to be said there. Actually, the first crankbait I ever caught a fish on was an Ish Monroe square bill. It was called a Big Papa. I think it was a River to Sea. And it was, it was a freaking game changer for me. It was the first largemouth I had ever caught on an artificial bait ever, and it was on this crank. I had no idea what the hell I was doing with it, and then boom, I happened to hook up with a beaut, if you will. I got CT Blue Line Outdoors, says Rick Kloon, Danny Brower, and Brandon Polinick. We've got Stan the Taco 113, says he wants to fish with Scott Martin, Bill Dance, and Ike. We've got RL Denny Dose, says Bill Dance, Epic Eric, Manny Chi. And do we have, oh, we have, we still have more to go. I knew that one of these was a huge category. Joe Ledford, and we have a story from Joe Ledford coming up. Joe Ledford 2302 says Jacob Wheeler, Butch Brown, and Oliver Ng. We've got Ryan William says Jeremy Wade, John Costello, and Robson Green. Pockets Grigio says Ted Williams. Now that's an interesting one. Ted Williams.
The splendid splinter himself.
Yeah, Randy Moss and Roland Martin. I kind of, you know, honestly, I would like to be on that boat because, see, I know Pockets Grigio. I've known him for a long time. He plays some of my trivia nights here and there, and he likes to get out there and get on some bass significantly. And he is one of these guys who is a wealth of knowledge and information and has an amazing conversation. But I think him and Roland Martin together might be a riot on that boat. I just, something about that chemistry, I think, would be freaking awesome.
And on top of that, Randy Moss will probably bring some good bud.
That's probably true. Yeah, probably. Yeah. Drop Shotters says, kicking their bass, Norm and Scott Martin. Norm, yeah, Norm getting a little love on this. Look at that, fishing with Norm. Johnny Morris, Bill Dance, and Hank Parker. That comes from Fishing with Porter. Paul Pavlosky, 33, says, Elvis, Trump, and JFK.
On the same boat?
I don't know if it's the same boat or one at a time. That would be rather interesting right there.
Oh, my God.
Yeah. Very, very interesting. So let's go ahead and jump into one of the other questions, and this has been a popular question the whole time with this podcast, has always been about, you know, fishing tackle. And the old saying that fishing tackle catches more fishermen than fish. So these are some of the items that you guys said you are you think is the most ridiculous stuff out there. And then the follow-up question is, are you guilty of using it? Kenny Goes Outdoors says, big swim baits, primarily thinks that they're ridiculous for the cost. And yes, he's guilty of using them. Albert Rock 2000 says, the duck lure and the spider lure, never tried either, never will. What do we got? Emriv says, those battery-powered swim baits, no, not ever. Jared MFN Martin says chatterbait, hands down. That's it. Most ridiculous the world. Okay. Steven D'Imbrogio says probably topwater rats in California, and they work really good. So I'm going to assume that you've used those. I am a believer of topwater rats. As a matter of fact, I think I alluded to it, but I have to do a little minor surgery on my BBZ 40 that I've got because I had I got a big strike. And I thought it was just a missed fish. And when I got the lure back to me, I have one small segment of the tail left. So I don't know if it was a snapping turtle or what. I know there's big snappers in this lake. It probably was that happened to get away with the rest of it. So it comes with a replacement. So I've got to swap that out. But I got to take it inside and find some toothpicks that'll work to lodge it in there. But so that's pretty interesting stuff. We got Umbrella Rig from Mass Homegrown 69. Umbrella Rig, no, I haven't. They look very fun to me, though. CT Blue Line Outdoors says, still struggling with baits and prices for many of them. Yeah, there's a big window there for all types of different baits. Connecticut Blue Line Outdoors says, the giant hard swim baits. That's like a cult. Like, you get into those big swim baits, like the big glide baits and stuff. Like, there is so many, like, there's a very specific angler that kind of appeals to. And it feels like once you kind of go down that rabbit hole, you're never the same. You're always looking for that kind of bite. In fact, Fishing with Becca had just posted a video not too long ago with like a good large scale golden shiner swim bait, and she cleaned house with the sucker. Absolutely. And I think, you know, it is. It's kind of crazy. The multiple whopper plopper, and no, I haven't used it. That's from Stan the Taco 113. RL Denny Dose says, the Tokyo rig, yes, I've used it, has not been successful. Reed Pennington says, Guggen. That's it. Let's see. Joe Letford says, bat and or bird lures. Fishing with Porter says, the Banjo Minnow. Yes, I've used it. I caught minnows. R&R Outdoors says, Googan anything. Trailbreaker 747 says, that baby duck by Savage Gear, haven't had a single bite on it. Mike Birch Outdoors says, swim bait finesse. Cam Holston Fishing says, using a penis crankbait, and it worked very well. Really?
Well, for I saw those on Facebook, and I was laughing. I'm like, well, that's ridiculous. But I actually got a how many did I get? I got like six of them in different sizes. When I retired, somebody thought they were cute and gave me a set of small gold penis spoons, which are still in the bag sitting downstairs. It's not going anywhere. I don't use spoons anyways. But thanks to Tim Edmond, Tim Catfish Edmond, one of my old airmen, for giving me a large set of penis spoons. Appreciated. They will never be used.
There's a couple of like novelty penis baits that are out there. The crankbait, I think there was one of the Googans had done a challenge using like the worst baits. It was either like one rod, one reel, or John B, I think, had used one of these, and it did catch fish. And then I've seen those spoons before. Like I've seen them advertised on Facebook or Instagram and like the sponsored ads and things. It's kind of crazy. Ellie Noel says flat worms, no doubt. Flat worms. Okay, so
what do you mean flat worms?
Huh?
Well, give me an example.
I don't know. I'm not familiar.
Flat worms.
Yeah, flat worms. I don't know if she means like worms that have a flat bottom, like the, I'll give you an example, like the Dragon Drop or the Slim Shake from Googan. Each have a flat bottom, like it's a flat poured plastic. Or, you know, as opposed to like a Senko that's rounded all the way around, or even almost any curly tail is the same way. It's got, you know, the body shape all the way around.
Who sent that one in?
That's Ellie Noel.
Ellie, give us some details. Send us a link in the email. Thank you.
Ellie's actually going to be on the show sometime shortly. Good. Yeah, she's going to be on the show. Hopefully, she's kind of a riot. Like her Instagram is fantastic. So I'm hoping to have her on soon. So she should be on, and I can follow up with her about that then. What else do we have here? Do we have any other stuff that people wanted to get out there? I think that about does it for the questions as far as people getting stuff out to me.
What about yours? What about the undead minnow butt plug or the zombie minnow butt
zombie
plug?
Zombie minnow butt plug. You know, I honestly have to kind of say that when it comes to that kind of jazz, as far as what we've got for baits that are out there, things that I have found that are novelty or have been looked at novelty that are probably pretty good is the, what is that? The flying lure, I think, is one that I'm intrigued by. And I would really actually like to kind of play around with, because especially when I'm out with Tim Jacks and we're out, you know, flipping docks and things like that, something that I typically don't get to do or now will be able to more with the kayak, I think that could be a presentation that could just absolutely be killer. But it's one of those things that you just got to play with. Okay.
I'm telling you, they kill for docks, man. I will not put them on that list. I have some up in Minnesota, and when I'm throwing them around docks, it's game on.
Well, and that's the thing. I think that items like that that are looked at as like either ridiculous or like eyebrow raising, we'll say. It, you know, I mean, we've seen that things that come out are obviously, they might seem a little bit off the mark or something, but I mean they have the ability to work, and sometimes they just absolutely slap. So your first impression might be that it's ridiculous, but when you actually start using it, like I'll throw the rat out there. A year ago, I was like, why would I throw that? Why would I throw a topwater rat like that? It doesn't make any sense. And now it's, if I can get away with throwing it, I'm going to throw it. Absolutely, because I just think it's killer. These questions coming, I think, are the best. So this was kind of like a little ask me anything type thing, like ask the show what they want. We only got three responses from this, but they're all actually pretty good questions. I'm going to actually ask you, Sean, to share yours first, because I feel like I have many that I can go on here. But what is it?
I was 17. It was a summer day.
RL Denny Dose sent us a question and goes, what's the most embarrassing fishing experience you've had?
Wow. Embarrassing, huh?
Yeah. I think I know what mine is, and it just happened.
All right. I'm going to tell you this, and you know what? God damn it. I should have included this on. See, this is exactly why I want to do an AMA because this is another story. I'm going to give you guys a preview.
Yeah.
Of the series that's coming up, the final or whatever, the next series of Sean the Fisherman questions, or Sean the Fisherman stories. So I was out fishing with a friend, the friend that is involved in the upcoming series.
Yep.
Right. This was probably 1993, 1994-ish. We were waiting and walking the bank of the Chicopee River. He had two fishing rods with him. I had one. I had a spinning rod. I had not yet learned to use a bait caster. He did. And he had his first, I think, low profile. And he put it down. And I said, well, I'm going to go ahead and take a cast off that.
Oh, God.
You know what happened. I backlashed the high holy shit out of that freaking reel.
Yep.
And I reeled it all the way in and I put it down.
Oh!
And he came back, and if he's listening to this, the truth is out. It's been 20 plus years, 25 years. The truth is out. He goes, what the hell, dude? What'd you do to my rod? I'm like, I didn't touch your rod.
That right there
is
that right there is some Bernie's H.O.T. stockroom shenanigans if I've ever heard them. Oh, my God.
I'm embarrassed that I did that, and I'm even more embarrassed that I tried to bullshit my way out of it. He knew goddamn well I did that.
So you were like, I'm not picking this out. And this, oh, God. Wow, that is amazing. That's great. We're breaking down the levels of Sean the Fisherman's psyche right now. That is crazy.
Yes, you know, just so around the mid-90s, I mean, that's when you and I met, and you know damn well I was a piece of shit back then.
It's
debatable.
Were.
It's debatable how much I am now, but back then, there was no question.
That reel looks cool. I'm going to give it a whirl. So I have one that I can throw out there, and it's I have some that are relatively recent, all that involve the new kayak. But this one was so embarrassing, like the worst. Hands down, the worst. So let me set the scene. This was just a few weeks ago. You guys listening may remember there was a post I had thrown out there saying, got a day to myself today, going to go to one of two bodies of water. And I listed those bodies of water and ran the poll. And people voted on what they wanted. I went to that body of water, and I got skunked over there. I did ultimately fish it, but the mission in getting there was ridiculous. So at this time, my goal was to take the kayak off and launch it alone for the first time and give it a whirl. Now, I had attempted this with a friend of mine, and I had dumped it and rolled the kayak, and I think I had mentioned that before, and it was embarrassing as hell, but it was just the two of us. Nobody saw this. Nobody saw this. It was just my own bruised ego and a bunch of, like, you know, a couple of lost items and some things that needed repair afterwards. That was my own mistake, and it is what it was. This time around, I'm at a local body of water, and I go to launch the kayak. And one of the things that I had been trying to do is to get into the kayak without having to get into the water. You know what I mean? Stand on the kayak and then just sit down. That is not easy for somebody of my size. And to do so without, like, you know, like in my kayak, there is it's almost like a dog leash. You can clip it. There's a spot to clip, and you can use that to they call it like a lift assist strap. So you can stand up and pull yourself up like that. It's built in that way. I just need to replace the strap. Well, I go to get in the kayak, and I looked up a video. I've been watching a lot of stuff with Chad Hoover on YouTube. And Chad, especially, I watch his stuff because Chad's a bigger guy. And, you know, he does a video about properly launching from a kayak. And what he does is he puts the kayak parallel to the bank. And he says, you step on with the foot closest to the bank. So that way you're not stepping on the other side and it rolls you right over. And then you stand right on the kayak and you just sit down. Simple, right? Should be simple. I sit down in this kayak. I'm standing on the kayak for the first time ever, and I'm like, we're good. We're there. I just have to sit my fat ass down. I sit down, and my seat style is a drop-in seat, and it doesn't lock in any way. I sit down, and the force of me sitting down and sitting back pushes me onto my back. Now the back of the seat is on the laying flat on the kayak, and my legs are dangling up into the sky like some kind of asshole. As this happens, the force of my body landing on the kayak is enough to push it off the bank. Now I'm floating away from the bank. I'm on my back like a turtle on his shell, totally out of control, and I have my paddle locked into place with the what they the Ascend calls a rod tip protector, but really I just use my paddle. I clamp it in there, and then it's good to go. It as a place to hold the paddle and keep it out of my way. I'm like, I've got the paddle, I'm good. I look to my left in my rod holder, and I have my BBZ Rat 40 with those giant treble hooks right near my face. I look to my other side, and I have a jig. I'm like, all right, so rolling this over and getting out is not an option. This is going to be very, very bad hook-wise if I do this. I need to figure this out. So I grab the paddle, and I start trying to paddle myself over to the bank so at least I can get a little bit of stability and then get up. Now, mind you, I'm a 300-pound guy. Like, I am not able to just right myself without there being, like, a problem potentially. So I go over and I paddle, and I just, for the life of me, I can't get myself close enough or get the leverage to put the bow up on the bank enough to be stable. Like, I can't do it. So I'm waiting, and I in my PFD, which I was happened to be wearing in my pocket right up near my chest, I had my phone. So I unzip my phone and I call friend to the show, Paul. I call Paul because he doesn't live too far away. I make a distress call and say, hey, bud, I know you got a lot of stuff going on today, but if you could do me a solid and come down to Lake XYZ, I need you to come and just grab the handle of this kayak and pull me up about 3 feet onto the bank. And I explain the situation. At this point, I'm actually saying out loud, don't lose your mind. Everything's going to be okay. Just relax and figure this out. And I'm waiting for him. I end the phone call. He's on his way. And as I hang up and put the phone back, I see another fisherman walking down the trail to fish along the bank. And I give him a holler for some help. And he comes over and he says to me, I thought you were sleeping. And I'm like, you a-hole. Who would sleep like this with their legs dangling up in the air like a freaking moron? Floating halfway off the bank. And I asked him to just pull me ashore a little bit. And he grabs the handle of the kayak, pulls me up about 2 feet or so. I was able at that point then to roll myself forward and put the seat in the upright position. It wasn't landed correctly. I had to get off the kayak and then fix that. It was the most embarrassing thing, and it qualifies as the most embarrassing only because that other fisherman was there, and that line forever is going to ring in my brain for the rest of my life. I thought you were sleeping, you freaking asshole. I've never felt more like an idiot in my life.
I'm picturing you like from the Christmas Story, the younger brother rolling around in the snow because he can't move because of his snow gear. That's just how the image of my
mind. That's exactly how I felt. It was awful. Like I was, you know, and immediately I was like, okay, this is bad. Don't freak out. Just you're floating. That's what you're going to do. And the thing that really frightened me was that there is a small dam not too far from the launch where I was. And if I had float around, if I were to float around up on that water, it's possible I could go over that dam and that would suck. That's what I was really afraid of. So, yeah, that's my most embarrassing story. Absolutely most embarrassing story, RL Denny Dose. I hope you enjoyed that.
Wow.
Oh, goodness. So, next question. This one, I saved the screenshot, and I don't know why I said we have three questions. Bryant899 asks, how good are your baits? Do you think he means, like, baits that we make or baits that we use?
Wow. I am so confused at that question. I don't know.
I think what he wants to know, I think he's assuming that we make baits. So I'll say that they're garbage because they're not real.
Well, why sell us short? They're the best, dude. Send us money. We'll get you some.
That, you know what? You're right. They're the best. They actually, you know what? If you can get them on the hook, they will catch fish every time. Every time.
Yeah.
You know, all you got to do is
fish will jump into the boat. Just knowing you have those in your tackle box, the Jigs and Bigs official lures that may or may not exist.
We're awful. And then this question, I was saving for the end. It comes from Albert Rock 2000, which, by the way, Al is a longtime listener. He's been listening to this podcast since we started. He's a Texas-based guy, and he recently moved, I think... I forget where he was from, but he recently moved to, I think he's in the San Antonio area now, and he's been adjusting to fishing down there, and he's always hitting me up with either pictures of fish that he's caught or sharing stories about things out there. He's recently gotten into drop shotting, and which is great.
Sorry to hear that.
Seeing some results, which is great. But he has a good question. He goes, have either of you thought about making it out to Texas to fish? Absolutely, 100% yes. That is on the docket. Like, it's part of the plan. Once this show is at a certain point where we can travel and go elsewhere, that is my goal, is to go not just Texas, but some of these other amazing states that with amazing waters and just experience the country out on the water, whether it's dragging my kayak along or if it's someday we manage to get a big boat for the show. I 100% would absolutely love to do that for sure. And, you know, who knows? Who knows what could happen? I've actually been entertaining the idea of my wife's plan to get a pontoon boat, because I know we'll use it a handful of times every year, and then it'll just be an on-the-water studio. So I'm okay with that. Like, could you imagine wearing wireless mics, recording the podcast, and just actually fishing and talking with people?
We'd have to get you'd have to get the model with the grill. There's a bunch of models out there that have grills. I mean, if we're going to do it right.
Well, I mean, Holly wants me to get a model that has a couch, so you know that there will be a grill, 100%. Like,
you got to get, we got to get it embroidered or something with. That will be the actual
beef seat.
Beef seat. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
100%. I probably will take and get the, get it reupholstered with a pattern that looks like a close up of like a roast or a steak.
Well, yeah. That sounds like a blast. I think we can do that.
You know, I mean, hey, she keeps talking about wanting to do a pontoon boat, and I'm like, well, if we do it, you're not going to be happy. Because let's be honest, I'm going to get my money's worth out of it if it was something that we end up doing. But, you know, I would absolutely love to go and fish in Texas. Texas is a huge state with a whole lot to offer. And some, you know, there are bass that are of some significant size that New England anglers have a lot more challenge to catch than if you go in other parts of the country. Plus the people, like, I'd love to go fish with Albert. And I think that would be absolutely fantastic. Be absolutely killer. Yeah, Texas, California, Florida, Washington. You know, I mean, New England states, I think, are so easy. I've already gone to a handful of them this year, which kind of blows my mind, even just getting out there. You know, Vermont, Connecticut, and, you know, I want to get into Rhode Island a little bit. I want to go and check out some of the good stuff in New Hampshire and Maine. But, yeah, there's a lot of states. I would love to take this on the road, and even for a short period of time, and get out there and fish with listeners, fish with guests, and just have a blast. So I'm all about it. That is good stuff. Good stuff. So now, this next portion, this last piece that we have here, I went and flagged a bunch of the messages. The last question that I had asked, and it's sort of like the core of the show, is to share those two stories. The moment of fishing where you're super duper proud, and then the other story where it's just an epic fail, where everything went wrong. And to be honest, like, the whole reason why I throw those stories out there is because no matter the angler, no matter the experience, no matter anything, you can relate to these. Because we've all been there. We've had moments of extreme joy and extreme, like, wah, 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 you know, at one point or another, everybody's been there. And it's these kind of stories that sort of like bring us together as a community. And it's pretty cool. So I'm going to go ahead and jump on. So we got R&R Outdoors, Rod and Re-Rod. Let me go ahead and back this up, because his story spawned a little conversation on Friday. We kind of took it a whole other direction. He said his most proud moment, and this is like, you can't go wrong. He goes, watching my son toss his Paw Patrol pole and bobber for a bass setup and then pounding a 3-pounder on his second cast. You, my friend, have made an angler for life out of that young kid. That is amazing. Like, when you have that experience so early on, like second cast, I mean, like, he's hooked. Quite literally, no pun intended, like, he is hooked forever. That kid's going to be fishing for the rest of his life now, trying to chase that level of joy and up that amount. Like, that's a great, a 3-pounder for a kid that age, that is awesome. Absolutely awesome. I think he actually got it on video, too. That's the thing.
Awesome.
Yeah, I think he got it on video because that's what it is. Yeah, he put it on Instagram. So you know what I'm going to do is I'm going to actually share it, and you can check it out on there. So it's pretty badass. And then he says that this one's going to get sentimental as a fail. He goes, not taking my dad with me fishing as much as I should. Dad had a stroke in 2016 that made him unable to work. I take my son out every chance that I get, and I always send him pics of our catches, but never make the time to go and get him to tag along. Biggest fail. I am in that same camp. I do the same freaking thing. I saw my dad yesterday, and I told him, we got to make some time and go fishing, and I have to freaking just do it. I mean, like, granted, my dad and I fish completely different ways. He doesn't use any artificial lures for the most part, anything like that. And I mean, he's not really, like, targeting anything. He likes to fish for what's biting. Or if he targets anything, he's targeting trout. But still, I got to make it a point to do that. So, Rodney, thank you, man, for throwing that out there. Because it got me thinking right away, I need to do the exact same thing. Great stories. I wouldn't call that an epic fail, though. It's, a little unfortunate. If you have the time, make the time, man. It is, absolutely. And then Joe Ledford had a couple of points that he made in here. He's got a couple of stories that he shared, one of epic pride and one of an epic fail. First one is that I was in a tournament and I casted my popper into some brush. We trolled up into the brush and I was reaching too far over the bow of the boat, then fell into the water. But only my leg went in because I fell on a log. So I was doing the splits with one leg in the water and one on the boat. Two of my buddies rolled by and saw me. That sucks, dude.
Wow.
Kind of impressive, you know. I mean, and lucky that you managed to catch that the log in there to kind of hold you up. I would assume. And then we have his story of epic pride. He goes, I was fishing with my cousins in a private pond, casted a wacky rig right where he had just casted, and caught a 6.5 pounder, which is still his PB. Wow, that's very nice. That's the beauty of fishing a private pond too. Oh. Man, that is beautiful. Nice job, Joe. Thanks for sharing, buddy. I appreciate it. And then Albert chimes in a couple. He says, most epic proud moment was when he caught his PB largemouth of 4 pounds, 11 ounces on a 5-inch June bug yum dinger stick bait. Most epic fail was just this past Labor Day weekend. Sight fishing a largemouth with a weightless salty super fluke in baby bass color from a 14-foot high wall. Tried for about 20 minutes, was ready to give up. Finally hooked him and reeled him up to the high wall for a picture. He then flopped out of my grip. I caught him, and then he flopped again, only to flop over the high wall and back into the lake. That has happened to me too many times from being up on a high place. And I've lost fish because I've used rods that were too light in strength to be able to flip them over and get them up that high that quickly. It sucks. Man, I've been there. That's soul crushing. It really is. Man, that is 14 feet is not a significant drop, or is not a small drop. That's a significant wall, man.
And, no, you can die from a 5 or 6 foot drop, and 14. There's a lot of luck involved with no injury.
Oh yeah, absolutely. And then you got a question like, how deep is that water? Like if you drop it. I get the most amazing part about that story though is that the fish flopped and he caught it. Never happened to me. I've never caught, like, if a fish is flopping, I'm just like, yeah, we know how this is going to end. You know, it's just like, I've never had that opportunity. We have video proof.
We have video of that on your on the measurement, on the how to do a measurement video.
There was a
fish flopping at the end, I believe.
Yep. Yes, indeed. So yep. I can definitely relate there, but I do think I wish there was video of that because I think the catching it, the like, oh, I got you now. Yeah. Oh, that's, man, I feel for you, Albert. That sucks, dude. Oh, first time. Oh, and he adds too, he goes, that was my very first bass to catch on a fluke too. Man, that's rough. So that was that was pretty damn good, I would say. Thanks everybody for getting in touch, and I'm going to do more of this stuff periodically. Not necessarily because I don't have a guest for the day. I'm going to throw some more questions out there every so often. If people want to jump in and share, maybe some of you guys that haven't shared your stuff, you can go ahead and get that in there. If you have a story that you'd like to share, like your most epic or epic as far as you know the story that you're most proud of, or an epic fail, you guys can always DM that stuff on the Jigs and Bigs Instagram, or you can email jigsandbigs413@gmail.com. Let us know what that stuff is, and we'll compile it and then start utilizing it later. Because, I mean, a lot of, you know, we talk, there's a couple of words that get thrown around a lot with our little, and family is one of them, but our little family of in the angling community, and community being the other one. It really is just that. All of this, it's a community, it's a family of people sharing stories about something that we have a common passion of, and that's kind of what this show prides itself on. You know, it's like we talk about gear, we talk about techniques, and we have a lot of laughs, but the whole idea is it's all about the people, the listeners, the guests. It's all you guys. So we appreciate everything that you're doing, and you guys keep listening. It is freaking awesome. Freaking awesome.
It's all about the people, it's all about the family, and it's all about poisoning them with hot sauce.
Yes, poisoning them with hot sauce. Indeed. You know, for a moment I was like, did I do something really bad here? Like, was something wrong about one of those elements? Like, did I give food poisoning to people? Like, I had never eaten hot sauce and had it affect me that way. Although, that said, it's like, I'm 43 now. You know, I probably should watch it with what I'm eating for spicy foods and stuff. But, good Lord, that was rough.
And on that note, happy birthday.
Yes, thank you.
Everyone who hasn't wished Bobby a happy birthday, wish him a happy birthday. I did, and that's all I got.
Yeah. No. It was really good. So, yeah, I got a lot of mentions. A lot of people had messaged and said happy birthday and stuff. Thanks to everybody. It was a great one. I cannot complain. Had a lot of fun. Definitely had a whole lot of fun on Sunday. And we're going to be doing more of that stuff. Like I mentioned earlier, we've got a plan to get out into the Berkshires and do some more fishing. Like anytime that we can collab with the Hooks at Hoodlum guys, their pro staff, and any of the friends that we've made in doing this podcast, like Delirious Angler, Stretching Lines Tackle, like a lot of these guys we want to work with and create just really, really great stuff. And, you know, hopefully, you know, everybody sees some success and some growth with it. That's the whole plan. You know, we just want to have a great time and make some killer content. So, and I think we have something really good going. The Hooks at Hoodlum's YouTube channel is going to premiere the video. I'm going to be sharing a bunch of that stuff. And I think we're going to be launching some giveaways very, very soon on a regular basis. So, folks, if you're listening to the show and you like what you're hearing, definitely remember, go and give us a review or rate the show on whatever platform you're using. We've been using, to get some feedback, we've been using Apple Podcasts a lot. We've gotten a lot of really good feedback from folks there. Go ahead and do that. If you have any friends that are into fishing and maybe haven't heard of the show yet, share it with them. Go ahead to Spotify and share that. You know, send them a message or just send them over to jigsandbigs.com and let the magic just do what it do, you know? That's what the website's there for. So, you know, share jigsandbigs.com. Let somebody know. Tell two friends, and they'll tell two friends, and then the network can grow and grow and grow, and we'll build something even bigger and better than we ever, ever, ever could have expected. So we're going to just kind of do our little outro here and, you know, and call it good. I think we have a fantastic show today. Sean, you have anything you want to throw in here on the outro?
I have said more than enough today. Thank you.
Beautiful. Beautiful. No, that works. Everybody, thank you so much. We really appreciate all you that listen, and we've got great stuff lined up for you. I've got amazing guests that are in the queue. We're going to go ahead and get some great content together for you. So we're looking forward to a really good fall season now, not just out on the water and fishing, but for great content. And as we get into winter, you know, we're hoping for some safe ice locally, but we're going to be out doing some ice fishing. And then we're also going to be doing some other stuff, too, that we've mentioned before. Like, we have a game show that we're working on with the Hooks at Hoodlum's pro staff. We're going to be giving away some great stuff and prizes as like a contest that's going to go, or a giveaway that'll line up with that game show. You're going to want to check that out. We're going to be doing some live stuff very soon, too, on the Jigs and Bigs YouTube channel. Yeah, there's a YouTube channel. You could go subscribe. There's no content there right yet, but there will be stuff there. And also, you'll be able to watch our lives on our Facebook page as well. If you don't follow us on Facebook, go over and like the Facebook page, facebook.com/jigsandbigs. Just do a search. You'll find it. Absolutely. Thanks so much, everybody. I am Bobby Roastbeef. I got Sean the Fisherman with me. Have yourselves a great, great, great week. Get on some fish and tight lines.